St Cyprian's school burnt down in a fire in 1939, much to the delight of many pupils.
One of the most fascinating things from the biographer's point of view about the St Cyprian's days and the essay Such Were the Joys is their connection to 1984, because it has been truly said by many a critic that the world of St Cyprian's is the world of the police state.
The cricket pavilion is the only surviving building from the school. Inside was the icy plunge pool that the boys had to run through each morning.
You had to walk up, come out of the changing rooms, walk up to the far end where the physical education man stood, and he was armed with, it seemed to be about a 10-foot bamboo cane, and as you stripped off and went up to the far end, he, if you didn't get in there quickly enough, he encouraged you.
The headmaster and his wife lived in this house. To the young Orwell, they were tyrants who submitted him to countless humiliations and floggings.
A near contemporary of Orwell's have literally remembered boys praying at their beds at night, "Please, dear God, please may I not fall out of favour with Mrs. Wills." The relationship between Winston Smith and O'Brien, who was interrogating him, at one point is couched very much in the imagery of the pupil-teacher relationship. I don't think he's actually, I think he may even be described at one point as resembling a headmaster or a scholar or a sort of sacerdotal figure. It is almost kind of cast in the idea of it being a delinquent pupil who is being brought in front of his headmaster for condign retribution.
"O'Brien," said Winston, making an effort to control his voice, "you know this is not necessary. What is it that you want me to do?" O'Brien made no direct answer. When he spoke, it was in the schoolmasterish manner that he sometimes affected. He looked thoughtfully into the distance, as though he were addressing an audience somewhere behind Winston's back.
And there's another possible source for the perverse relationship between Winston and O'Brien.
Orwell had a very distant relationship with his father. Again, he thought that he'd failed his father. He thought that his father disapproved of him. I think it'd possibly be true to say that Orwell was in search of a father figure in that sense, and that, you know, in some of his books, there is this quest for older male figures.
"You'll do what is required of you."
"What is it? How can I do it when I don't know what it is?"
"You will find that you know."
I think that the themes of the book is about guilt. And it's no chance that O'Brien is called O'Brien, O'Brien being a Catholic name. It's about the guilt associated with the Catholic faith. You know, the fundamentalist religion of totalitarian communism.
In O'Brien, we find hints of the schoolmaster, the father and the priest, and in Winston, the subject who, through circumstances beyond his full understanding, has failed him and been betrayed by him. This unsettling relationship plays a key role in making Room 101 a terrifying concept.
I think Room 101 has sort of made its impact, along with many other things that Orwell has said, simply because he was a very clever communicator, and he was able to fasten on to concepts that somehow lodge in the mind and produce fears, if you like, apprehensions, horror in some instances, that make us remember.
50 years on, Soviet Russia and corporal punishment are no more, but Room 101 continues to thrive, reinventing itself for each generation.
Well, I was working as a radio producer for BBC Light Entertainment, and I'd worked with Nick Hancock and a couple of pilots, as had every producer on the corridor. He was notorious for being in failed pilots. I think he had the record.
"I'm Nick Hancock, and this is the entrance to Room 101, the warehouse of the worst things in the world."
There was an idea kicking around for a bad record programme, and we decided to expand the idea to include not just records, but people, places, concepts. He said, "What about using the idea of Room 101?
"And we'll send leggings into Room 101. Well done, Maureen."
The is deeply shameful, isn't it? It's deeply, deeply shameful. It is one of the greatest novels of the 20th century. And I've taken it and made it utterly trivial. And a lot of people think Room 101 is a television programme rather than a concept in a truly great novel.
Back at her studio in East London, Rachel Whiteread and her technicians have begun the complicated process of assembling the cast.
It's like having a jigsaw puzzle. We have a kind of map on the wall. We know where everything goes. Everything's brought over here. Everything's labelled and it all gets sort of put together. Because I actually haven't finished the work and, you know, we have it here now in the studio. And it's cast, but there are all sorts of other things that I need to do to it and I need to think about it, and I also need to look at it as a finished work. And it's really at that point when I kind of work out why I actually made it. And, you know, I might think, God, this is awful, I'll destroy it. But I kind of don't think so. I think it's, you know, I'm intrigued enough by it and the surface is battered enough.
You know, the sort of pop marks, you know, they're just very sort of simple marks where there was, you know, maybe a piece of metal in the wall and something pulled out and, you know, you pull it out and you just get a bit left like this. It's just like information, you know, it's like Braille, or, you know, you could just touch this and feel the work. I think Room 101 is a place that we don't know about. It's a place where we can sort of put our fears, but, you know, and somehow I've made it concrete by casting it, and now it sort of exists. But Orwell's Room 101 never existed. It was a fiction, and I've had a kind of rather extraordinary opportunity to cast what was a fiction, and we now have an object that isn't fictional anymore. It's actually there and existing.
The year 1984 has been and gone, but Orwell's message is more relevant today than ever. Surveillance cameras mean that Big Brother watches us all the time. New anti-terrorism laws have made thought crime a reality, and Orwell's far-fetched notion of doublethink now exists as political spin.
My goodness me, doublethink is with us as we are here. You know, the fact that, you know, Osama bin Laden can have been created and paid for, as is Saddam Hussein, and then 10 years later, he's the devil incarnate.
I found it the most frightening book I recall for many, many years, because everything that was said in it about 1984 is emerging in very, very clear form now. The abolition of history, the distortion of language, the permanent enemy, the demonization, the loss of civil liberties. And with Bush and Blair, Big Brother, I think, is here.
Nobody believes a word now that the Prime Minister is saying.
I love Big Brother.
When so much of Orwell's book has come to pass, maybe we should be thankful that there's no real Room 101. As far as we know.
Australia on 4 starts on Monday with the story of three Aboriginal girls detained as part of 1930s government policy, attempting a 1,200-mile walk home. Moving film drama Rabbit Proof Fence is at 8:30. Tonight,